Well, the situation, not only in Germany, but many countries in the world in the 60s was like a powder keg and needed a little fire to explode.
Anti-war demonstrators protest U.S. involvement in the Vietnam War in mass marches, rallies and demonstrations.
You see, it was a time of the civil rights movement in the United States of America. A new dream was born, the dream of Martin Luther King in Washington in 63, and John F. Kennedy, the new frontiers.
A new era begins under the leadership of President John F. Kennedy.
There was coming a new socialism with a human face in Czechoslovakia, in East Europe. And there was Vaticanum II in the Roman Catholic Church, and the ecumenical movement came from one peak to another. At that time, we turned around to the other side to show how the hope in the coming kingdom of God, the new creation, can influence our behavior here, how we deal with social questions, political questions, and the questions of the destruction of the earth here and now.
It was in the midst of the turbulent 60s that Jürgen Moltmann, professor of systematic theology at the University of Tübingen, wrote The Theology of Hope, a work which overnight captured the imagination of the theological community and revived for the church its nerve to live in those troubled times. Since then, Professor Moltmann has continued to make major contributions to systematic theology, expanding and clarifying his vision of hope, the hope that the promises of God will be realized in his people. What was so revolutionary about the theology of hope? And how has it stood the test of time? The 17th National Conference of Trinity Institute was a celebration of the life and work of Jürgen Moltmann and his wife, Elisabeth Moltmann Wendel, a premier feminist theologian in her own right. Convening in three locations, New York, St. Louis, and San Francisco, guest theologians from around the world gathered to pay tribute to the Moltmann's work and to discuss the implications of the theology of hope for today's world. This VCR series, designed for parish use, will capture the highlights of that conference and of the individual interviews with each of the participants conducted by the Reverend Leonard Freeman, Director of Communications for Trinity Church. The series is divided into four parts. First, Jürgen Moltmann, A Theology of Hope. Second, The Theology of Hope, Critiques and Questions. Third, The Theology of Hope, The Feminist Response. And finally, The Theology of Hope, The Church in the World. This first segment will explore the basic principles of Jürgen Moltmann's Theology of Hope.
When I first wrote The Theology of Hope more than 20 years ago, I started with the assumption that Christian hope since Augustine had been reduced by the church to saving the soul in a heaven beyond death, and that in this reduction it has lost its life-renewing and world-changing power. With The Theology of Hope, therefore, I try to present the Christian hope no longer as such an opium of the beyond, but rather as a power of life that makes us alive. To accomplish this purpose, I focused then on the biblical promises of the new creation, the resurrection of the body, the new heaven, and especially the new earth in which the righteousness of God lives. Because there was in the Christian tradition no hope for the society, we neglected the society. And because there was no hope for the earth, we neglected the earth and abandoned the earth to the destruction which we see around us now everywhere. And therefore it was high time to open Christian hope for an all-embracing power.
This theology of hope has been a most creative and a most important voice to be heard at a time when, frankly, we didn't quite know in the 60s whether there was any hope, whether Christianity was capable of facing the multiple crises which had occurred in the Western world, the way in which secularization had nibbled away at the confidence of the Christian churches. And I think for there to be a theologian sounding such a strong note has been tremendously constructive for the churches.
How did you come to be a theologian?
Well, this is a mystery I still try to discover and to understand. When I was a boy of 14, World War II started, and my intention was to study mathematics and physics because I was fascinated by Einstein and modern discoveries of physics, etc. And then I was 16, and the whole class was from school was drafted to the anti-aircraft batteries in Hamburg in 43. And we were studying a day and standing on guard at the guns at night, waiting for the Royal Air Force, and didn't come, but then they came, and it was 1 week of bombing of Hamburg and in 43, and the firestorm went through Hamburg, and I was in the midst of it and survived, while many of my friends and classmates died around me. So since that time, my question is, why am I not dead as they were? Why am I alive? And I still have no answer to it. And that's perhaps how I started to become a theologian, because I wanted to find out whether there's any significance for me to survive these terrible experiences and the mass death of the people at that time. And then I was brought to the front only for a few months, and had learned enough of English to say to the first Canadian troops in the Reichswald, I surrender, and was brought then to prison camps, unfortunately a little bit too long, 3.5 years, first in Belgium, then in Scotland, and then in England. And in these years of desperation, I found faith in a Christian community and hope which surpasses the barbed wire in which I was fenced in. Well, and so I became perhaps a Christian, trying to understand the mysteries of my survival and my life, and became a theologian and came out of the prison camps with the intention to study theology.
You said that you have fought all your life against what you see as two wrong tracks, wrong alternatives in Christian theology, the pietistic and the secularist. In short form, what's wrong with each of those, and what does the theology of hope have to offer?
Well, to put it in one sentence, it's wrong that pious students do not protest and protesting students do not pray. This was our experience for a long time, until we found the first groups and formed the first groups where we learned to pray while protesting on the streets against the Vietnam War, nuclear deterrence systems, etc. And on the other hand, the pious students all of a sudden discovered the Sermon on the Mount and joined us on the streets.
A lot of people would cite you as the formative influence on their thought and theology. Who would you cite as being the primary influences on your thought?
Very influential upon me were my teachers at Göttingen University, the teachers of my wife and me. We studied together at Göttingen, Hans-Joachim Iwand and Ernst Käsemann, Otto Weber. They came out of the tradition of the confessing church in Germany and brought us to an awareness of the political side of Christian existence and Christian theology. Very influential was my Marxist or post-Marxist or whatsoever a Marxist friend, Ernst Bloch, who wrote the book The Principle of Hope and inspired me to look for the hope in the Christian tradition.
By engaging in dialogue with the Marxist Ernst Bloch, Jürgen simultaneously made a gesture across the most dangerous political division in the contemporary world, and at the same time faced the Marxist criticism of Christian otherworldliness. And by emphasizing hope rather than faith in the now celebrated substitution of I hope so that I may understand for I believe in order that I may understand, Jürgen sounded a less assertive, more tentative note than had been heard in Christian theology for many years.
What would you see as the primary discovery, or rediscovery, of the Moltmanns and their contributions to theology?
Oh, I have no doubt at all that it is this emphasis on hope. He is writing what he calls a messianic theology. That is to say, he is taking the word Christ, Christos, the Anointed One, the Messiah, literally, and is insisting in a way in which I think in America we would associate with Reinhold Niebuhr. He is insisting that Christianity is a messianic religion. That is to say, it has a sense of something which lies ahead of it.
He rescued us from the arid and, to my mind, thoroughly self-indulgent individualism of existentialist theology. He pointed both to the collective and political aspect of theology in a thoroughly persuasive way.
When I was a pastor, it was always extremely hard for me to preach on those texts that had to do with the coming of the Son of Man, or with the end of days, or the final judgment. Moltmann enabled me to see that there was much more in the gospel than I was able simply to fit into the prior categories of my experience.
I think I am an optimist because otherwise I would be a pessimist. And I am an optimist because of my indwelling pessimism. Is there any ground to be an optimist? Not on what I see, but in what I trust in if I listen to the gospel. There is the triumph of grace over against sin, and there is a triumph of love over against hatred.